Well, good evening. Let's pray together and entrust our time to the Lord. Father, thank you for your grace to us, and we entrust our time to you. Thank you for the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. We pray that we would handle it in ways that honor you tonight. And as we think about the reality of your holy justice, we pray that you would sober our hearts as well. So, we entrust our time to you. Pray that you would use it in ways that are pleasing to you. In Christ's name, amen. Tonight, our responsibility is to be back in the book of Revelation. So let's just take a few minutes to orient ourselves, to remind ourselves where we are as we move into kind of another subsection of the book. So in the outline that you have in front of you for tonight, there is the sort of structure of the book at this point. We're in the really second major section of the book. I know it has Roman numeral 3. Roman numeral 1 was introduction, the first 8 verses of chapter 1. Then we had the large section on the Lord among the churches, in which there is a vision of the glory and greatness and grandeur of the Lord Jesus Christ. There's that resurrection statement, you know, that's made at the end of chapter 1 when the Lord Jesus says, behold, I was dead and I came to be alive, and I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell. One of the great resurrection statements within the framework of the New Testament. And then we have the seven churches. So beginning in chapter 4 and verse 1, we have the first of the major, the first part of the major judgment section, the Lamb and the scroll. And you remember how in chapter 4, there's the vision of God himself on his throne. In chapter 5, he's holding a scroll. The Lion of Judah, who's overcome, comes in the form of the slain lamb, takes the scroll, and then in chapter 6 begins to open it. So chapter 6, just to notice the outline, the first four seals were opened, and the four horsemen as the acts of God's judgment preparing for the end of time. But let's look at chapter 6 and the fifth seal, which kind of breaks the chronological sequence, but it becomes very important to the part we're going to look at tonight. Chapter 6, verse 9, when he opened the fifth seal, that is the Lord Jesus is the one opening these seals on the scroll, I saw under the altar the souls of those who'd been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. They cried out with a loud voice, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you will judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? Then they were each given a white robe and told to rest a little longer until a member of their fellow servants, pardon me, until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves had been. So we have that vision of the martyrs in heaven who've been killed in the course of their faithfulness to Christ. And it says, for the word of God and for the witness they had borne, and the cry, O Lord, how long? And it's related to the altar in heaven. We'll pick up that imagery as we come to chapter 8 once again. And then the sixth seal in chapter 12, and by the end of that we have in verse 17, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who's seated on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come, and who can stand? And so now we are really pressing close to the time when Jesus is going to return in glory. This is now moved to the sort of the last part of the last days. And we suggested when we looked at that, this is very similar to what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24. Then shall come time of great trouble such as has not been nor ever will be again. So we're into the what for sake of convenience is called the Great Tribulation. And we'll see it as we move into further the 3.5-year period immediately preceding the return of the Lord Jesus. And then, having given 6 seals, John interrupts. Or I guess it'd be more precise to say God interrupts. Because instead of seeing the 7th seal, we have this interlude in chapter 7. And we looked at the description that's given there of the 144,000 that are said to be from every tribe of the nation of Israel, who are sealed for God's protection during a time of great persecution and opposition. And then we have on the other side of this time of trouble, in the presence of God in heaven, a great multitude from every tribe, nation, and kindred, and tongue, who are celebrating in the presence of God and have experienced spiritual victory, almost certainly through death. Because when the angel asks John, who are these and where have they come from? And John, knowing that he doesn't know the answer and that the angel does, and that's how it's supposed to be played out, says, sir, you know. And the answer is, these are those who've come out of the Great Tribulation. So we have at the end of chapter 6 this picture of the unbelievers who are overwhelmed by the judgment is coming, the wrath of God and of the Lamb. And then we have in chapter 7 God's people who will stand during that period of time, even if they lose their life, they are the ones who will stand. Now we come to chapter 8, verse 1. And in chapter 8, verse 1, we're back into the sequence of the 7 seals again. So verse 1 simply says, when the Lamb opened the 7th seal, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. Now what happens in verses 2 to 5, and we'll look at those in just a minute, is transitional. It looks back and it looks forward. And so if in my outline, I have the 7th seal, verse 1. I debated whether I would change it this week as I came in. I think I'm going to redo all of this and I'm going to have the 7th seal, verses 1 to 5. And then I looked at it again and think, it really... So what happens in verses 2 to 5 is that it summarizes and introduces at the same time. And what it's going to introduce are the 7 trumpet judgments. So in point of fact, in verse 2, 7 angels with 7 trumpets now appear on the stage, and that moves us into the period of the trumpet judgment. So we'll come back to that in just a moment. Let's just think about verse 1. It's rather striking that in terms of events on earth, nothing happens in this 7th seal. It simply says, I looked. Or when the Lamb opened the 7th seal, rather, there was silence in heaven for about half an hour. And that stands in direct contrast to everything we've had. If you think back in chapter 5 of chapter 4, there was this continual praise. They do not cease day and night praising him who's on the throne. Holy, 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 the one who was and is to come. And then in chapter 5, when the Lamb comes forward, worthy are you to take the scroll, take the scroll and to open the seals, because you have conquered. And then that is added to with other praise and other praise. And we've had that picture of this loud, because the emphasis is on loud in all of these things, all of this loud noise that's coming out of heaven. And then all of a sudden, and it's the Lamb who opens the seal. John is very clear on that again in verse 8. There's silence in heaven for half an hour. And it's apparently that the singing and the celebration and the worship comes to a halt. And there's silence. Now, on one level, you think, half an hour isn't a lot of silence. But, you know, at different times, I've said... In church contexts, We're going to take the next 2 minutes, and I just want you to pray silently. And from my mind, because I'm leading and I'm trying to sense what's going on, 2 minutes feels like an eternity. I always take out my watch, and I deliberately, at that point, make it sweep around, because I know that that quiet just, it's not the way we live, and it's not, and there's something about quiet when there's a group of people together that becomes kind of ominous in some way. You want to fill the silence. We're not talking about when you're off on your own. This is multitudes who are present. And so the question is, what is this silence all about? And it's interesting to read the commentaries. There's a bunch of different answers that are given, ranging from the really extremely unlikely to the rather silly. And the answer is, we're not told. But I think it's very clear. And that is that this is the kind of silence before the storm. This is the kind of waiting and watching because something enormously powerful is going to happen. And everybody's kind of catching their breath. It's interesting that we have this in the Old Testament in different places. For example, in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, and the whole first two chapters of Habakkuk is, Habakkuk begins, it's a great little book, Habakkuk begins by complaining, Lord, where are you? Look at all the sin that's going on in our country. How can you sit back and allow sin to be like this among your people? And the Lord says, tell you what, Habakkuk, I'm going to deal with that. I'm going to bring the Assyrians in, and they're going to bring judgment on my people. And Habakkuk says, you can't do that. You can't use the Assyrians. The Assyrians, and this is a really interesting comparison, but I've seen it in a number of places recently. The Assyrians were the ISIS of the ancient world. That's what they were known for. They were terrorizers. And they would come through with bloody force and power. And they were terrifying, and they were utterly brutal at that particular time. So of all of the people that you're going to talk about coming, I mean, ISIS, they're going to send ISIS down on Judah. And you can imagine why he recoiled in horror at that. And then God comes with promises, but he says the judgment is going to come. And as chapter 2 comes to an end, it says, after a series of woes, there's all these woes that are coming in terms of the judgment that is going to come. And chapter 2, verse 20 says, but the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Now, the interesting thing is that that's often used or was more traditionally in more traditional churches to be read as a call to quiet reverence because the service is beginning. But that's not its meaning in context. The context is God is coming and he's in his holy temple. He's going to come. You better shut up because what you are going to be terrorized by is about to come. Let all the earth be silent because you've got nothing to say before a God who's going to act in judgment. And you have the same kind of thing in the book of Zephaniah in chapter 1 and verse 7, in the book of Zechariah in chapter 2, that silence is the kind of anticipation of God's outpoured judgment. And even heaven, as it were, kind of pulls back to think about what is it going to look like when people receive the consequences of their sin and the judgment that is going to come. I think that that's the most in terms of what now happens is these trumpets are sounded. That's the silence. It's the silence of impending judgment. Sort of the judges come back in, the jury's handed the verdict, it's about to be read, and you can kind of cut the courtroom atmosphere with a knife at that point. There's this hush silence. Are you tracking with me here in terms of where that is? That seems to me to be what's going on. But nothing happens in quite the way we expect. Instead of the silence, all of a sudden, let's read verses 2 to 5. There is the preparation for some trumpet blasts. Then I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given to them. And another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer, and he was given much incense to offer with the prayers of all the saints on the golden altar before the throne. And the smoke of the incense with the prayers of the saints rose before God from the hand of the angel. Then the angel took the censer and filled it with fire from the altar, threw it on the earth, and there were peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. Now the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to blow them. The first angel blew his trumpet. We have the four angels. Then look at verse 13. Then I looked and I heard an eagle crying with a loud voice as it flew directly overhead. Woe, woe, woe to those who dwell on the earth at the blasts of the other trumpets that the three angels are about to blow. And so now we have, in this chapter, now we're going to talk about three woes. So you have the four trumpets and then three woes, which are also trumpets. So you look down at verse 12. The first woe has passed. Behold, two woes are still to come. And the sixth angel blew his trumpet. And then we have the second woe that is spoken. Then, exactly the same pattern that we have before. End of chapter 9, interlude. And instead of talking about the third woe, the seventh trumpet, we have something about an angel with a scroll. We have something about the two witnesses. And then we come to verse 15. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet. Chapter 11, verse 15. And there was loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. So let's just notice a few things that are going on here. First, the seven trumpet judgments are really the content of the seventh seal. So we have half an hour of silence, and then these seven trumpets come, and that's really kind of using the imagery of a telescope. We've had the seventh trumpet, and then we get the seventh seal, and we get the seven trumpets that stretch out, but they're all within the seventh seal. The seventh seal, the seventh trumpet, and the seventh bowl all end at the same place, as we'll see in just a minute. But it is the intensifying of judgment as we get closer to the end times. So, the seven trumpet judgments are, remember the seals? We had four, the four horsemen, and then we had two, the one we read of the seal of the martyrs in heaven, and then the terrorized people on earth, interlude, and then the final one. So that's exactly what we have here. Four, these four trumpets, then two, the two woes, interlude, seventh trumpet, third woe that come together at that particular stage. The trumpets and the bowls, so I have you, so look at this for just a minute. the trumpets and the bowls are in some way, there's some similarity, but it's interesting to notice the pattern that happens. So some of them are very similar. So the first trumpet, hail and fire is thrown on the earth, one-third of the vegetation. The first bowl, painful sores on those who have the mark of the beast. The second trumpet, the sea is turned to blood. And in the second bowl, the sea is turned to blood. But you'll notice in the second trumpet, one-third is affected. In the second bowl, everything in it is killed. The third trumpet, this falling star that affects fresh water and it's poisoned, turns to blood and leads to death. One-third of people die related to the fresh water. The third bowl, fresh water is turned to blood, and there's an announcement that God's righteous judgment has come. The fourth trumpet, celestial catastrophe, so that there's darkness. In the fourth bowl, the sun doesn't come dark. It turns brutally hot, and so it scorches the earth. Next week, we'll look at the fifth trumpet. Some locust-like creatures come out of the bottomless pit, and they bring 5 months of torment. Painful sores are part of the bowls, and you can look at those. The sixth trumpet deals with Euphrates. Same reference in chapter in the bowls. So what you have is some. They're not in the same order. They don't follow the same pattern. But there's a connection between the two that you can see in some particular way. Sometimes it's straight across, but there's an intensification. So the number with the seals, can you remember how much was affected with the seals? One quarter. Then under the bowls you have under the trumpets, one third, and then under the bowls you're going to have virtually everything affected. So it's as if we're in the end time and it's getting compressed and more intense in terms of the judgment and its effect on those who are there. One other thing to notice, on the back of the page, there is some connection, and this is kind of explicit, it's not ever stated directly, between the Exodus plagues and the trumpets and the bowls. So some of them are pretty obvious. The first plague, the Nile is turned to blood. Well, under the second trumpet, a third of the sea is going to be turned to blood. The third trumpet, a third of the sea is going to be turned to fresh water. And you can notice the connection as well with the bowl judgments, just to follow the trumpet judgments down. The first trumpet the seventh plague was hail that destroyed all of the crops in the area of Egypt, not in the land of Goshen where the Israelites lived. And the first trumpet judgment that we have in this chapter is hail and fire falling on the earth. And then in the seventh trumpet, we'll have that again. Heavy hail, which is part of the great judgments on the earth. The fifth trumpet, which we'll come to next week, the locusts were the eighth plague, correspond to the fifth judgment, and then the judgment of darkness, which was the ninth plague, corresponds to the fourth trumpet. So clearly there's nothing sort of a pattern here. There's just sort of, this is kind of like Pharaoh and Egypt ramped up with some parallels. And it's useful to think about that, because the point of the plagues in Egypt were primarily to demonstrate the glory and the power of God. On the other hand, those plagues were to demonstrate the weakness and the powerlessness of the Egyptian gods. So, for example, the plague of darkness, well, the main god of Egypt was the sun god, and Pharaoh was the incarnation of the sun god. Or the river Nile was worshipped because it was the source of life. Well, the very first judgments come and they hit the Nile. They worship the bull, and you'll have the cattle that are destroyed. And you have this pattern over and over. There's a book on the book of Exodus, and it's entitled simply Moses and the Gods of Egypt. And the point of the writer is the 10 plagues were really a demonstration of the gods of Egypt being defeated and being shown as no gods at that particular time. But the striking thing is those plagues poured out by God didn't soften Pharaoh's heart. They hardened Pharaoh's heart. And we'll see, especially as we get into the later trumpets and then the bowls, it will say they did not repent. They did not repent. They did not repent. So one of the effects of the plagues is not simply to reveal the glory of God and to reveal the powerlessness of the Egyptian gods. It is to reveal the depravity of the human heart, that men will not turn, that God shows his greatest exhibition of love. He gives his son and turn their back on it. And God pours out his judgment. We've already had that in chapter 6. When God pours out his judgment and they know it's the wrath of God and the Lamb, what are they asking? Not to repent, but to hide us from it. And so there is something about the hardness of human hearts that is exposed in the midst of this, that people will do. There are obviously some, and a good number, who believe during this period of time. But for the great mass of people, God's outpoured judgment is a revelation of their depravity, and only confirms the righteousness of God in doing what he is doing in terms of pouring out judgment. Okay, we're going to look at the text now, but let me just stop and see if there's any observations that you want to make or questions that we should be observing, remembering the microphone rule. Yes, Connor.
I noticed the parallel in between that the seventh trumpet was, and it's a copy of the seventh plague in Egypt.
Hmm. It is an interesting connection, but the difference is, of course, the seventh one is the last of the trumpets, but it's only the seventh of 10 of the plagues, so it's not the last one. The last one is, what's the last plague?
The 10th plague was the death of the firstborn son.
The judgment of the firstborn son, that's right.
Of course, the Israelites were spared from that.
Pardon? If they obeyed and they killed the lamb and put the blood on the doorpost, that's right. So, okay, anyway, Jordan.
Can you make any comment on the fact that in chapter 8, verses 3, 4, and 5, it looks like the symbolic instrument that's used to start the trumpet judgments is the censer that the angel was holding, and that this censer had just previously been used as a vehicle for the prayers of the saints.
Yeah, I'm going to come back to that in just a minute. So okay. I want to go back to verse 2 and then we'll pick that up.
Okay.
But that's a very, that's a very meaningful connection there to just notice that. So just pause for a minute. We'll come back.
Connor and Donna, you know that I was going to have a question. We've just read about the 144,000. Mm-hmm. Do you think that simultaneously, while these judgments are going on, are the the 144,000 select from God, his messengers, are they administering on the earth? I mean, his salvation story?
Yeah, there. My assumption, and I can't prove this.
Right.
This is all what seems to be the logical thing, that the sealing of the 144,000 happens earlier than this, and they are carrying out their ministry. Yeah. And simultaneous with God's outpoured judgment, it'll be interesting, I didn't make this observation earlier, the first four trumpet judgments are directed against nature.
Yes.
The fifth and the sixth are directed very directly against humanity. So you have the judgment being poured out on the earth, but at the same time you have God bringing into being this great company who've come out of the great tribulation, who've come to faith and are following the Lord in the midst of that faithfully. So, two kind of work intriguingly side by side. But we see evidence of that. I've been reading a couple of really intriguing books about... One has an interesting title. It's called Too Many to Jail. And it really relates to what's going on in Iran. And the problem that they're now facing is because there's considerable evidence that there are perhaps as many as 400,000 Christians meeting in house churches in Iran right now. And while there are some who are in jail, and we know their names, the Iranian leadership said, we can't, there are too many to jail. I mean, that's their title. And that's all happening since Khomeini. And a lot of it has to do directly with what happened with Khomeini and what happened with Ahmadinejad, that's opened people's hearts to the gospel. We know all kinds of Iranians outside of the United outside of Iran have come to Christ, but in Iran as well. And I was reading one story. This one comes from Somalia, and it's a striking. The book is called "Killing Christians," but it doesn't. But it really is talking about the witnessing of Christians. But they are smuggling Bibles into Somalia from Kenya, kind of the opposite of Shabab or whatever that the terrorist group that keeps doing these terrible things, killing all those Christians just last week. And the way they have done this, one of the significant ways, is a living Christian will get in a coffin underneath a dead body that's being taken back either to Kenya or Somalia, travel there for 4 or 5 days under this dead body, and some of them have died in the process, and then come back, and they will come back filling the bottom part of the casket with Bibles, and the body on top. And I read that story and thought, oh, Lord, I'm grateful that you didn't call me to that ministry. But you just become aware with a great humility of how those two things that seem impossible, great suffering and yet great working of God's power and God's spirit at the same time. So... I'm sorry. When we were in China, I'm not even sure how many years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, we'd been in Beijing and preached in the big church there. People lining up for an hour and a half outside of the service to get in, all kinds. And then we went to another city, and there we were meeting with house church leaders, and kind of being very careful about coming into the house and not giving ourselves away. And I can remember asking, Elizabeth, you can correct me if I don't remember, but I can remember asking them, which do you think has been better for the church and its growth? The prosperity that you're experiencing now or the persecution that you had a few years ago? And they were very quick. They said, oh, the persecution. People were far more open to hear the gospel than they are now with all of the prosperity that is going on. And that's, am I remembering that right?
They said that there's a robust faith that comes when there's resistance, and it diminishes as you feel more comfortable with that. There was a change in your
Well, I think in the hard days, they were called to worship before the idolatry of Mao and the Communist Party, and they realized that was bankrupt many of them. But there's something about consumerism. They said, we feel sorry for you Christians who have to live under the pressure of consumerism all the time, which I thought was an intriguing view of things. Okay, let's go back to the text here, to verse 2. So, we've already read this. This begins with the statement that all of a sudden he sees this other vision. I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given to them. And as always, you get a statement like that. I saw the seven angels, and everybody, who are the seven angels who stand before God? And some go back into Jewish literature, and some Jewish literature talked about seven archangels and names them, although the lists are not the same in Tobit and in several other of Jewish writings. I think they're just seven angels. It's clear that John doesn't want us to pay any attention to them, except they have access to God's presence in some way, and they are given seven trumpets. Now, it's worthwhile thinking about trumpets, because trumpets play a fairly significant role in the Old Testament, and they have a number of different functions. The shofar is probably what the ram's horn that is blown is probably the primary thing, although there was this little instrument as well. But it was used as a military signal. That was a primary way in which a trumpet was used. It was used to rally the people together. On the average day in the temple related to feasts that were offered and trumpets that would be blown, 21 times a trumpet would be blown every day within the nation. There was the Feast of Trumpets that announced the new year. There was the coronation trumpets when a king was... So we have to ask, what are the trumpets? And I think, again, almost certainly here, this is more like the call to war or the trumpet of warning. Some here think of the story of Jericho, where you have seven priests who blow trumpets one a day, and in anticipation of the great judgment that is going to come as they circle the city each day, and then on the final day. That may be in the background, but again, those were all trumpets of warning, trumpets of impending judgment, so that fits. But all of a sudden, as Jordan has just reminded us, we have this intrusion of another angel came and stood at the altar with a golden censer. And again, who is this other angel? Some are so convinced he's at the altar in heaven and he's offering incense before God that they think that this is Christ the high priest. And it's Christ who's seen here. One of the interesting things when I was pastoring in Dallas is that Dr. John Walvoord, who's sort of the guru of prophecy, was in the congregation. And I always thought, I've got to preach on these passages with Dr. Walvoord there. But he was one who believed this was Christ. And as kindly as possible, I think it's clearly wrong, because there's no way Christ would just be described as another angel. That this is another angel. This is not the Son of God, the Lamb of God, who's been worshipped and all of that. So this is some angelic being, obviously a very high rank of some, and he comes to the altar with a golden censer. Now, behind this is tabernacle imagery from the Old Testament. So you remember that in the Old Testament, you had the tabernacle as it was laid out, and you had the outer court. And in the outer court, you had the bronze. Sorry, I should have tucked in this cord properly. You had the brazen altar where sacrifices were offered continually. You had the laver, or the basin, where the priests would wash, related to that. And then you had this smaller tent structure that was divided in two. You had the holy place that had the furniture in it, the table on the table of the bread of presence, or as the King James puts it, the table of showbread, 12 loaves that were placed there to represent the nation of Israel. There would be the golden candlestick that represented the nation before God, and then you had the altar of incense right before the veil, and on the other side, you had the Ark of the Covenant and the seat of propitiation where the high priest would act once a year. So what would happen in that whole thing was that the priest who was offering would go outside into the outer courtyard to the altar of sacrifice, take some of the coals off the altar of sacrifice, put them on what's called here the censer, which is just a flat pan with an open top, and it was made in the tabernacle of bronze in the Temple of Solomon. It was made of gold, but I sort of wonder how that worked, because if you put hot coals on it, how are you going to keep it from melting under that? But nevertheless, that's what the text says. And he would then take the hot coals on this censer, and he would sprinkle incense on it within the holy place. It was Levitical incense. It was forbidden to be used anywhere else. And that would be placed on the altar of incense as a sweet-smelling aroma to the Lord. And nearly all of the sacrifices, both outside in the courtyard and then, of course, with the coals from the sacrifice, would be offered. Now, the picture here is of the altar of incense in the holy place in the presence of God. And he's seen standing there, and the suggestion or the statement is made, he was given much incense to offer with the prayers of all the saints, a golden altar before the throne. Now in chapter 5 and verse 8, we are told that the elders had incense, which is the prayers of the saints. So it represents the prayers of the saints. This is a little bit different. It's not quite the same, because it says that the incense is offered with the prayers of the saints. But incense is a symbol of prayer and praise. Now, that's where chapter 6, verses 9 to 11 come in. Because there we had people, remember, under the altar offering prayer. And the prayer that they were offering was, "How long, O Lord?" And so the prayers, and this is not the prayers of the martyr. In chapter 6, it was the prayer of the martyrs. But you notice this is the prayer of all the saints. But it seems to be prayers for God's justice and God's kingdom. There's a sense in which every time we pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven," we are praying for God to act in judgment on the earth. Because God's kingdom, when it comes, is going to come in judgment at places where his will is... I'm sorry, if this is irritating you, watching me do this, it's irritating me far more to do it. So, the prayer is offered before the Lord. And first of all, there's this offering of the prayer to the Lord. And then all of a sudden, the angel turns around and flings the censer with the hot coals down onto the earth. And that's the picture that's given in verse 5. And when that happens, there were peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. Now, let me just go back and think with you. Peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. Think biblically now. Where does that take you first? To to Mount Sinai. Exodus chapter 19, Israel out, the mountain which they could not touch unless they be killed, and the barrier put around it, and God's holy presence in his holiness and justice, and the evidence of his presence. Then, if you remember, in chapter 4, when we saw the one who was seated on the throne, in that picture it said, from the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder, and before the throne were burning seven torches of fire. So in heaven, we had that picture of this evidence of the rumbling, shaking, ominous holiness of God. And now this is cast down on the earth. And this is a kind of epitome of the judgment. Now, take your Bibles and turn with me. And we've looked at this before, but just to remind you of it again. Chapter 11 and verse 19. Well, look at verse 15. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and it describes a bunch of things. And then it ends, God's temple in heaven was opened, and the ark of his covenant was seen within the temple. There were flashes of lightning, rumbling, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and heavy hail. And then in chapter 16, when we get to the seventh bowl of the seven bowl judgments, the seventh angel poured out his bowl, chapter 16, verse 17, into the air, and a loud voice came out of the throne from the out of the temple from the throne, saying, "It is done." And there were flashes of lightning, rumblings, earthquakes of thunder, and a great earthquake such as there's never been since man was on the earth. So great was that earthquake. And then it talks about the judgment of Babylon. Now, the point is that the seventh seal, the seventh trumpet, and the seventh bowl all end the same way, with a display of the holiness and judgment of God. And now we're going to get the trumpet judgments that are reinforcing this. So in some way, we're going over the same territory again. They all end at the same place. Seventh seal ends with this rumbling theophany. The seven trumpets will end with this. The seven bowls will end with it. And so we're getting a condensed kind of picture of judgment as we get closer to the end. But let's go back to what Jordan said. The thing that is significant here is that these judgments are seen as God's answer to the prayers of his people for justice and for his kingdom to come. One of the reasons God is going to act in this way is to answer our prayers. When we ask that evil will be crushed, when we ask that God manifest his glory, when he destroys the effect of sin on the earth. So Jordan, you've been thinking about this while I've been talking away. Anything that you want to add to that or hitchhike in terms of... Thank you, but okay. It is here though that we run this. How do I, as a Christian, think about ISIS? How do I think about the group in Somalia? How do I think about Boko Haram? And part of it, praise the imprecatory psalms. God, judge them. Stop them. Deal with them as they ought to be dealt with. And yet at the same time, there's a sense in which we pray, Lord, convert them. Change them. Meet them. Do what you did with Paul. And interrupt their course. So as Christians, while we love our enemies, we still are taught to pray, and it's rather striking. Same psalm, same sermon that said, love your enemies and do good to those who despitefully used you, also called us to pray, your kingdom come, your will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. And that is a call for God's judgment to take place, because his kingdom will not take place apart from the judgment of sin. And we live in that kind of tension between those two ideas. Am I just confusing you here with what I'm trying to say? I think I'm confusing myself. So, okay, then let's look at these first four trumpets. When we get to the trumpets, quite honestly, this is one of the more challenging parts of the book of Revelation, to try and see how it all comes together. One of the challenges is this purely symbolic? Or is it more literal in some way, but still dealing with the kind of things that doesn't quite fit? Just trying to describe things to us using first century language, but we live in a very different time, and so how would he put it in our time? That's one particular question. I mean, we have this all the time in the Bible. We're going to have descriptions of the final end of people riding chariots and horses being killed, and the idea that means that there's going to go time back when there's horses and chariots seems a little far-fetched. They were using the language of the time to communicate to them. But it strikes me, and some will take this and attempt to make it into just simply descriptions of famine or descriptions of the burning mountain we'll read about in a minute, they see as a great kingdom that's destroyed. The language seems to talk about ecological catastrophe. And even though it's difficult to put this all together, as we'll see in a moment, I think we're best to say as much as we can, ecological catastrophe is a central part of it. And you'll notice as we read verses 7 to 12, there's four judgments, and the word a third is mentioned, I think, I counted it earlier, and I think I remember it in my mind properly. I think it's used 12 times in this passage, so there's this strong emphasis on a third as against what was a fourth in the fourth of the seal. So let's just read these together. And the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared to blow them. So these are now God's heralds who are announcing these things. The first angel blew his trumpet, and there followed hail and fire mixed with blood. And these were thrown on the earth. And a third of the earth was burned up, and a third of the trees were burned up, and all green grass was burned up. So part of it's clear. The description is an enormous impact on vegetation. A third of the trees, a third of the earth, a third of the green, or all the green grass, the hail and fire mixed with blood. What is that? That hail, I can understand. But it's interesting that the emphasis here is not on the hail. Hail was the thing in Egypt that destroyed everything. But this talks about a third of the earth was burned up, a third of the trees were burned up, and all the green grass was burned up. So the emphasis is not on hail, which doesn't burn anything. It flattens everything. This burns in some way. Is this looking at some massive set of electrical storms? I don't know. That's not exactly blood and fire. I don't know what to make of that. But somehow something happens that has fiery power and has huge ecological damage. Second angel blew his trumpet, and something like a great mountain. So even there, John is protecting. Is it a great mountain? No, it's something like a great mountain, but it's not a great mountain. Burning with fire was thrown into the sea, and a third of the sea became blood. A third of the living creatures in the sea died, and a third of the ships were destroyed. I think the next one we're going to see fits a comet or a meteorite. It could fit here, but a great mountain, is this a volcano that's being described with all of the eruption? Even if it is, how do you have a localized mountain that affects a third of the waters of the earth? I don't think we're told how we can try to put that together. in any meaningful way, but something catastrophic happens, and the emphasis here is on the seas and the sea lanes. Even today, if you think of the amount of stuff that comes through the port, I mean, we live just off the 10, the most heavily traveled highway in terms of shipping in the country. When the docks are down, you know, when the strike was on recently, talking about all the ripple effects, and you think of even today where we are. In Roman times, they talked about the shipping lanes as being the blood vessels of the Roman Empire. And even today, most of the stuff that gets shipped around the world can't be carried by plane. It's by these huge boats and tankers and all of these other things. Something catastrophic happens to the salt water. And then the next is something catastrophic happening to the fresh water. The third angel blew his trumpet, and a great star fell from heaven, blazing like a torch. And it fell on a third of the rivers and on the springs of water. The name of the star is wormwood. Wormwood is a herb that was incredibly bitter, and cumulatively it would become poisonous. It wasn't innately poisonous, but apparently cumulatively it was poisonous. Third of the waters became wormwood. Many people died from the water because it was made bitter. Star falling from the sky, you can read comet or meteor there, but how does a meteor or comet affect the world and only affect fresh water supplies? I don't know of any way in which that's a possible thing to do. So we've got the effect, and the effect seems to be clear. The means is put very vaguely, and we don't know this. But you can imagine what that is doing to life on earth as is being lived. And then the fourth one is again curious. In its ways, and I'm going to let Martin explain all of the cosmology of this one. The fourth angel blew his trumpet, a third of the sun was struck, a third of the moon, a third of the stars, so a third of their light might be darkened, and a third of the day might be kept from shining, and likewise a third of the night. Well, the third part's clear, except I don't know how you strike a third of the day and a third of the night and you make it dark, but the larger picture is an eerie, ominous darkness. And you think of the dark, the ninth plague just before the Passover, and you think of the darkness at midday, at the death of Christ. Darkness as this sense of judgment. And in the book of Matthew, when Jesus talks about this, he says the sun will be darkened. You have it throughout the Old Testament. So some kind of cosmic effect that affects the earth in some particular way. But this isn't just something astronomical that's happening. This is some supernatural event because the result doesn't fit anything that we know is possible. Unless you can explain it to me. So I'm going to turn it around and ask you to explain to me these four trumpets and how they're working out judgment. But the effect of it is the important part. Serious, devastating effects on the ecology, vegetation, fresh water, salt water, and this ominous darkening of everything. Not a good time to be alive. Any questions, observations, solutions? Bob?
Relate to anything, but I just wondered what it was that poisoned the waters there in Moses' time that he had to fix so that it was drinkable again. Would it have anything to do with this wormwood stuff?
No, I think that was just bitter water, meaning that it was undrinkable, and you can think of all kinds of ways that water gets undrinkable, especially because most of it would be water in a desert that only is comes because of the becomes because of the rains or the floods and then sits there and stagnates. you know, in the Exodus as they're moving through the desert. So stagnant water becomes impure water. I don't think it's related at all to this. I mean, the miracle there is that God changes the water by the casting in of a tree, which there's no cause and effect whatsoever. Throwing a tree in and all of a sudden stagnation is removed. It was a miracle. So, Sharon.
I'm just curious about the hail and fire mixed with blood. Do you have any idea about the blood? Is it maybe from birds falling out of the sky and they're bloody? I mean, what could it be?
I don't have the slightest idea.
Okay, me neither.
Some have speculated that this is due to, and this is just, they're just guessing, but this is a volcanic eruption where you have red ash falling, you know, out of the sky related to
it,
but
it may not be literal.
It clearly isn't literal blood. But what is it? It isn't a great mountain. It's something like that. I mean, it's just sort of. Yes, sir.
What does the stars mean in the last one? Does it mean the planets and galaxies too?
Well, the way they would be seen by us on Earth, apparently, is what's going to be affected. I don't know whether they would be affected or this would just be what God did in stopping their light from coming through in some particular way. Just like when he made, for Joshua, it looked like the sun stood still.
Yeah.
But the sun didn't in actuality stand still, but its light didn't shine at that particular point. So,
yeah, the sun,
it's a miracle of what
still.
A miracle of what would be called refraction rather than a miracle of creation. So,
yeah.
Evan.
What confuses me is, wouldn't everyone in the world that's not a Christian have to see it? So would they all be in the same place?
No, apparently, I mean, I don't have any idea how God's going to look after the worldwide part of this. I know that some people used to say, well, that's why God invented television, so people could watch it there. But I doubt that that's the way it's going to happen. I don't know, Evan. The trouble with having grandkids here is they ask questions that you can't possibly answer. It's a blessing to have you, but it's just you ask hard questions. All right. Thank you for your patience. We're going to struggle with this at several points through here and just try to say, you know, this is what it looks like, but we can't be sure. There are some, and this is where you can really go well off, but there's some who note that the word wormwood in Greek, which translated wormwood in Greek as synthos, is related to the word Chernobyl in the Ukraine, and this may look at some kind of nuclear issue. Well, I don't know. I mean, some of this stuff, if you think about a nuclear, but that's just kind of, you know, there's no connection between wormwood in Revelation 8 and Chernobyl, whatever it was. And so we can, Hal Lindsey was very good at those kind of things, but it wasn't useful. So, Father, it's easy to turn this into a kind of puzzle of trying to figure out these things and what they represent and what they stand for. But I'm reminded again that this speaks about the truth that you are a consuming fire, and it is a terrible thing to fall into hands of the living God. So help me to have more of a compassion for those who do not yet know Christ, and more of a sensitivity to seize the opportunities to share the truth of the gospel. In the Savior's name, amen.